Okay. All right, my name is Brian Lauer, and we're going to have a ball talking about dinosaurs tonight. We're going to focus on what's true and what's false. And some of the topics that I cover are going to be controversial, but that's not a bad thing. A controversy just means there's strong opinions on each side of an issue, and it's up to you to study it out and come to your own conclusions. Because I'm not here to tell you what to think. I'm just here to give you information, something to think about. The main message for tonight is separate the facts from the fiction, especially with dinosaurs. Okay, dinosaurs, there's a lot of facts around there, and there's also a lot of fiction, and it's up to us to separate them. I mean, the fiction is opinions, conclusions, interpretations, stories, guesses, and you're going to see that. There's one question that can separate a fact from an opinion, and this is your general ed textbook right here. And this is what it says here at St. Cloud State. It says, a fact is a verifiable piece of information, whereas a conclusion is a judgment based upon the facts. The news media often mix facts with conclusions without indicating which is which. And that second sentence there, oh my, it's like the pot calling the kettle black. The science books do the same thing. They mix the conclusion with the facts. And so what's the question that can separate a fact from an opinion? It's, can you verify that? Okay? Can you verify that? Facts are verifiable. You see that? A fact is a verifiable piece of information. So the question I want everybody to get good at asking is, could you verify that? And that's the pop quiz of the night. We'll see how many people remember that. Could you verify that? Just four words. And I'd like to have everybody think of these fossils, these dinosaur fossils, as clues to what happened in the past. All right? And these clues, it are very important that we interpret them properly, because if we don't, we're going to have the wrong perspective about the past, the wrong perception about the present, and the wrong focus to the future. And that could be devastating. That could be really devastating. If people who don't learn from the past are doomed to repeat it. And so these fossils here have been found on every continent, even Antarctica, which is quite a head-scratcher. How do you get dinosaurs? This is the 8th grade earth science they use in St. Cloud here. It says that the South Pole is mostly covered by ice, but fossils show that crocodiles, dinosaurs, and palm trees once lived on the land. How in the world do you get palm trees to grow in Antarctica? And alligators, about the only thing living in Antarctica right now are emperor penguins. And it's a miracle that they can live there in that sub-zero degree weather, 100 degrees below zero. And just Google search that. Watch that on YouTube. It's a miracle. That wasn't going to evolve. But how do they do that? The fossils show that they lived there. How in the world? That tells me that there were some dramatic changes in the past on the Earth's history. Okay, and some of these fossils are huge. If there was a dinosaur in this theater, it would go right through there. How many people have heard of Dreadnoughtus? Okay, you've heard of Dreadnoughtus. Yeah, they found it in Argentina. Yeah, and it's almost as big as a jet. And look at it. It makes that elephant look like a puppy dog. Okay, this thing is huge. And the thing that would impress you the most about him is if he stepped on you. You'd be deeply impressed, or depressed, one of the two. Okay? But now let's separate the facts from the fiction. Okay, the facts. Okay, this and it's going to meet the headlines. You find something that big, it's going to make the headlines. And this is the story in USA Today. Again, they said that the media mixes the facts with the conclusions, and they do. So his team recovered 70% of the bones Dreadnoughtus had below his head. So 70%. Pop quiz. Who remembers the question we're supposed to ask? Who remembers? Could you verify that? Very good. Can you verify that? Yeah, there the bones are. No problem. Verify it. That's a fact. Okay, we can verify those bones. That's a fact. 70%. Okay, how about this statement? Some 80 million years ago, a raging torrent swept away two Dreadnoughtuses, perhaps already dead, before dumping them on a bed of quicksand-like sediment. In a stroke of luck for scientists, the mire swallowed the animals whole. Pop quiz, what's the question? Could you verify that? Can they verify that? Do they have a DVD of that? Do they have a signed affidavit? Do they have eyewitness accounts of this?
No,
they can't verify that. This is not a fact. This is their interpretation of the fact. So you need to separate those two. And so, but why would they say that, they had to be swallowed whole? Let's read about the university write-up. Drexel team uncovers Dreadnoughtus, a gigantic, exceptionally complete sauropod dinosaur. And it says it was 85 feet long and weighed 65 tons. What's the pop quiz? Can you verify that, right? Could you verify that? Well, the weight has since shrunk down to 40 tons. So weight is harder to verify than the length. And I figured, well, you got 70% of the bones, that should be easy to stretch out, just measure that. But it's interesting, these are the bones that they found, and this is what they have when they put it together. It's like they have a three-dimensional jigsaw puzzle without a picture on the front. And now, Dreadnoughtus, they had 70%, and this is what they make right here. So there's a lot of pieces missing right here. They got pretty much half of it, but they don't have a lot of it. And so that's just that's paleontology. But and now this is as good as it gets. They said 70%. Okay, Argentinus, this is the biggest dinosaur ever found. And this one is only known from half a dozen vertebrae, and it's bent back and a shin bone and a few other pieces. So can you imagine putting together a jigsaw puzzle without the picture and missing 90% of the pieces? And this is what they get. In the square, these white bones are what they found, and this is what they draw. All right? So that's paleontology. There's a lot of wiggle room in that. And even the creation museums, they have an Allosaurus, and they do the same thing. This is in the museum in south of Cincinnati. They're missing a lot of the fossils also. The blue ones are the ones they have. The tan ones are the ones they add. So that's what's happening in paleontology. But they do have the skull. That's pretty rare to have a whole skull. But back to Dreadnoughtus. Okay, it's a 30-foot long tail, a vertebrae with a diameter of over a yard. So a vertebrae this big. How'd you like to be that? And that chiropractor. But again, can you verify that? Sure, you can. There they are. There the bones are. That's a verifiable fact. How about this statement? And you remember that the Dreadnoughtus had to be swallowed whole? Why did it have to be swallowed whole? This sentence explains it. The two skeletons are evidence that these individuals were buried in sediment rapidly before their bodies fully decomposed. They have to be buried rapidly or they're not going to turn into fossils. All right, that's going to be important later. And then it says that these two animals were buried quickly after a river flooded and broke through the natural levee, turning the ground into something like quicksand. Pop quiz, excuse me, can you verify that? How do you know it was a river? You got a DVD? You got an eyewitness account? You can't verify that. That's not a fact. How do you know it wasn't a tsunami? How do you know it wasn't a worldwide flood? What makes you think it was a river? So separate the facts from the conclusions. And this is what National Geographic draws, and it's probably a pretty accurate representation, but we really don't know what the head looked like. We don't know what the skin looked like. But again, it's pretty close. It would be like if you had to put together this. Who knows what that is? Anybody? If you had to draw that, would you draw something like this? It's an elephant. If we'd never seen an elephant, what are the chances that we draw that based on the bones? So we have to get really good at separating the facts from the fiction, or your life could get really messed up. I was at the community college last year, and I was talking to a woman, and she said that her daughter was going through confirmation. Okay, and so she asked the priest about dinosaurs. And I thought, oh, this will be interesting. Because the Catholic school in Tulle, cathedral here in town, they teach evolution in the science room, and they teach creation in the religion room. And I thought, and the Pope goes along with evolution. And I thought, what's that priest going to say? And so I asked the mom, I said, what did he say? And she goes, I don't remember. But her daughter wasn't very happy with the answer. It was pretty much just believe it because I said so, which is a horrible answer because we're supposed to be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh. And there's a lot of people with a lot of questions about dinosaurs. And so she asked a good question, but she got a horrible answer, and so she came to a horrible conclusion. And she concluded that either Adam and Eve are false or dinosaurs are false. Okay? And how could dinosaurs be false? They're in all the museums, all the textbooks, all the, you know, it's in school, in universities. How could dinosaurs be false? So with her logic, Adam and Eve are false. And if Adam and Eve are false, the Bible's false. You know, if God can't communicate clearly in the beginning, how is he supposed to communicate clearly in the middle or at the end? And Jesus said, if I have told you earthly things and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you heavenly things? And so she's in a real pivotal place in her life. She's really close to kicking this Bible out of her life. And that's going to be a shipwreck. And a lot of kids are in that position. I've seen stats of 66 to 90% of the students or kids in church stop going to church once they leave home. And it's because they doubt the Word of God. They doubt the Word of God, and they started doubting the Word of God in 8th grade, or in junior high and high school, basically 8th grader science, 10th grade biology. They're going to pound evolution down their throat, and they better believe it because their grade depends on it. They aren't going to give another option. Okay, and so she's at a real pivotal spot. And so I looked at her mom, and I said, Adam and Eve are true, and dinosaurs are true. The thing that's false is millions of years. okay? And I gave her some information. I plugged her into my YouTube site. But when I say that, Adam, and I say that dinosaurs are millions of years is false, that can be pretty shocking to a lot of people, because we're taught that ever since we can read, right? And so I just got to ask a real quick question. How many people think that millions of years is true? Just anybody think they lived millions of years, okay? And that's understandable. Why is that? Why do you believe on millions of years?
Say again, sorry?
Why do you believe in millions of years?
I feel there's more evidence for it.
Evidence? What evidence?
Dating.
The carbon date, the radiometric dating? Okay. Are there any other reasons that cause you to believe in millions of years?
I can't think of any. The rest off the top of my
head. Right. And see, this is what we're taught. As soon as we can read, here's a cat in the hat. Not hundreds of years, but not thousands, but millions of years before you were born. Okay, millions of years. So you get on that path. Radiometric dating. Okay, now the thing to understand about radiometric dating is there's three unknowable assumptions. Okay? And this story will help illustrate those unknowable assumptions. It's called the spaceship story. Just imagine that spaceship. Spacemen come to Earth, and their whole goal is to figure out how old the high school students are. And so they do some observational science. They measure all the high school students, and the average height is 65 inches. And then they measure the growth rate. And again, verifiable. They measure the growth rate, and it's 1 inch per year. So they figure, well, if they're 65 inches tall, 65 divided by 1 inch per year, they figure high school students are 65 years old. And they write their paper, and the parents freak out and say, no, you're wrong, they're teenagers. So they scratch their head, maybe we did something wrong, so they do some more science. They try to verify it another way. And they weigh everybody. The average weight for high school students was 130 pounds. The average growth is 2 pounds per year. So 130 divided by 2 is 65. They confirmed it, they validated it, they went off to wherever they came from, and they think high school students are 65 years old. So what went wrong? What did they do wrong? They had some good observational science, but they had some bad assumptions. And that's exactly what's happening wrong with the dating process. They see that, what did they do wrong? They thought that the initial condition was zero. The child was zero at time zero, and they were wrong. They thought that the growth rate was constant through their whole life, and that was wrong. And they disregarded eyewitness testimony, and that was wrong. What's wrong with radiometric dating today? Same thing. They don't know what the initial condition is of that rock. So you got a parent element that decays into a daughter element, radioactive into stable, uranium into lead. They don't know what the initial condition is of that rock at the beginning. They don't know if there was any daughter element in there at the beginning. They don't know if the decay rate was constant over time. They don't know that. And they also don't know if the specimen's been contaminated. And what's going to contaminate it? Water. Water can wash elements in and out. That's why we don't have lead pipes. And they also disregard eyewitness testimony. And that's a problem. And I've gone through the textbooks, okay? The 8th grade earth science, 10th grade biology, college books here. And I've seen that they only show one way of thinking. It's all atheistic. There's no God at all. And that's dangerous. They're just showing one hypothesis, and that's dangerous. Dr. Chamberlain is the first geology department, head of the geology department at the University of Chicago, and he warned researchers not to let one hypothesis dominate their thinking. Instead, they should always have working hypotheses, competing ones, so that kids can actually think. They can sharpen their analytical skills. They can compare and contrast. Otherwise, you just memorize and conform. And with these science books, that's what I see, a lot of memorizing and conforming, and that's why I'm here. I want you to have something to think about. And so where did dinosaurs come from? Okay. There's only two options. They were either created or they evolved. That's it. Either God made them or they made themselves. But now some people are thinking, well, wait a minute, maybe God used evolution to make the dinosaurs. You know, could that be? And if there's any atheists in here, just give me a moment to address this issue. You know, couldn't God use evolution to make the dinosaurs? Well, of course he could have. He's God. He can do whatever he wants. But what God can't do is lie. So if God said he did it in 6 days, he did it in 6 days. And some people say, well, you can't take Genesis literally. You know, that was communicating to an ignorant people. It's just a framework and an analogy or a figurative language. And so I was on a radio talk show out of Louisiana one time, and somebody called in and said, you know, the Bible says that God made man out of the dust of the earth. And that's what evolution says, that man came from the dust of the earth, and that's how God did it. He said, it's just an analogy. And I said, well, the Bible also says that the first woman came from the first man's rib. How does that fit into your analogy? And he couldn't answer that. But we'll give you Genesis. If you don't want to deal with Genesis, we'll just throw it away. Even though Jesus referred to Genesis more than any other book in the Bible. And Jesus always referred to Genesis as an accurate historical event. So if you're not referring to Genesis as an accurate historical event, you're not following the example of Jesus, and you're on real thin ice. But we won't even use it. How about Exodus? Any Christians think we can take Exodus? Or even the Ten Commandments. Can we take that literally? Or can we twist that up? You know, God wrote it with his own finger on a rock. He said, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not steal. Can we twist that up to make it say whatever we want, or is that literal? How many people think you can take the Ten Commandments literally? Okay, the vast majority. Okay. Well, write this down. Exodus 20:11, right smack dab in the middle of the Ten Commandments, it says, for in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that in them is. And then rested the seventh day. In 6 days, God made everything, right in the middle of the Ten Commandments. Literal. Okay? And I was on a radio talk show out of Valley Forge, Pennsylvania, and the co-host said, couldn't each one of those days be millions of years? And I said, what verse in the Bible causes you to think that? He's not getting that idea from God's holy word. He's getting that idea from man's corrupted word. And I said, besides, it doesn't make sense anyway. Because if God made the plants on day three, can they live millions of years without the sun on day four? And even if they could they live millions of more years without the birds and the bees to pollinate them on day five? And it just doesn't make sense. I was talking to a woman one time, and she found out I gave these talks, and she said, what side are you on? And I said, creation? How about you? And she said, can I say both? And the simple answer to that question is no, you can't say both. Well, why not? Because it breaks laws of logic. It's illogical, the law of non-contradiction. Two opposing things can't be true at the same time, at the same way. And I could show you 20 some of these examples, but let's just focus on the whale. Okay, who can tell me when the whales were formed? When did God make the whales? Who knows? Anybody? Anybody know when God made the whales? He made them on day five, the sea creatures, all right? And when did he make the land animals? Anybody? Rick, you should know this.
Day six.
Yeah, the land animals made on day six. So the Bible clearly says that the whales were made before the land animals. Evolution clearly teaches that life began in the sea, evolved onto the land, and there was a land animal that evolved back into the sea. So can you believe that land animals, or that the whales came before land animals and after land animals at the same time? No, it's illogical. It's like trying to believe that this podium is in this room and out of this room at the same time. It's not. You just can't. I mean, just basically pick a lane and get in it. That's what we're trying to get people to do. And you understand that both the creationists and the evolutionists, they got the same evidence. The same rock layers, the same fossils, the same radiometric dating, everything's the same. So why don't we agree on our results? One reason. Our belief system about the past. One believes there is a God, the other believes there isn't a God. And if there isn't a God, you need a whole lot of time to get stuff to mutate into what we are today. And so that's a problem. That's a problem. Basically, our belief systems about the past are different, about the present and the future. Tonight, we're going to focus on what we believe about the past. And we'll see which one the science actually validates. Okay, so we got two starting points for dinosaurs. And the challenge we have is Christians don't realize that the Bible is their starting point. They're trying to fit dinosaurs into the Bible instead of using the Bible to explain dinosaurs. And the other challenge we have is that evolutionists don't realize they have a starting point. They think they're objective, and they're not. Ken Ham was getting interviewed by Eugenie Scott. She's the head of an atheistic organization out in California. She was interviewing him when the Creation Museum opened up. And she goes, you admit it then, you start with the Bible, don't you? And he goes, yeah, that's right. And you're not prepared to change anything in the Bible, are you? And he goes, nope. And you're not prepared to change anything in Genesis? And he says, nope. She goes, see, that's religion. You know, your ideas are stuck. I'm a scientist. We start with the evidence and we develop our theories, and when new evidence comes to light, we're prepared to change our theories. You know, that's real science. You know, your ideas are set, mine are not. And Ken Ham says, Dr. Scott, can I ask you a question? He goes, sure. He goes, see, you're saying you're an atheist, is that true? And she said, yeah. And he said, yeah, that there's no God? No, no God. And the Bible's not true? No, the Bible's not true. Do you believe the creation account in Genesis? And she says, no. And he goes, are you prepared to change any of that? See, she's just as set in her atheism as Ken is set in his Bible. And this guy was honest enough to admit it. This is an evolutionist from Kansas State. He said, even if all the data point to an intelligent designer, such an hypothesis is excluded from science because it's not naturalistic. And we're going to show you that. They're going to have to plug their ears and close their eyes so they don't see design. And Francis Crick is going to reinforce that. So basically, where did dinosaurs come from? According to God's word, he made them on day six. They're land animals. Well, we can't use that. So now we're left with man's idea. So where did dinosaurs come from? Well, you got dinosaurs there. They came from amphibians. They came from fish. Came from marine invertebrates. And so, hey, did Scott make it tonight? Is Scott here from Holiday? He said he was coming. Okay, he didn't make it. All right. He was going to the science museum. And tomorrow, it's his birthday. So this is at a science museum. How many people believe everything in a science museum? How many believe everything the museum tells you? All right. Okay. Well, this exhibit is at the Chicago Field Museum. Do they have, now again, this is verifiable. This is verifiable. These lines, what do you think they have for that? They don't have anything for those lines. That's fiction. That's an interpretation. So be careful at those museums. They did the same thing with the bird evolution. Again, this is verifiable. We got the fossils. What's this stuff? It's an interpretation with no evidence. It's a figment of their imagination. So again, separate the facts from the conclusions. And this guy said it himself, Stephen Gould. He's no creationist by any means. He said the extreme rarity of transitional forms in the fossil record persists as the trade secret of paleontology. That's right. And Colin Patterson of the British Museum of Natural History, he said there's not one transitional fossil. And so this is, and then in the museums, they're going to have the dinosaurs here, the mammals there, two different ages, and that's not going to reflect reality. You know, what they found in dinosaur layers up at the top, you got all three groups of fish living today, both major amphibian groups living today, all four reptile orders living today, most are all bird orders living today, and all three types of mammals living today. Why don't they mix them together? Because that's real hard on that atheistic evolution theory. Understand that museums are the churches of the atheist. That's where they go to get their unbelief solidified. And that's what this guy said. The paleontologists have found 432 mammal species in the dinosaur layers. 432. And there's a book up here called Living Fossils. You can take a look at them. Okay? The only thing that's different, the fossil record is basically it's a record of a flood. It's not a record of millions of years. The things that you find in the fossil record are either animals that are alive today or animals that are extinct. There's no transitional anything. But is that what they're going to put in the museums? No, they're not. And this guy visited 60 museums. And he didn't see one complete mammal skeleton with the dinosaurs. Not one. So what you're seeing in the museums isn't a reflection of reality. Just like the geologic column, that's not a reflection of reality either. That doesn't exist anywhere in the world. It's a mental construct to help you believe in millions of years. Which of you is right, creation or evolution? I like to say, which one can answer this question? What evolved first, the heart or blood cells? Let's ask you guys here. What evolved first, the heart or blood? Who thinks the heart evolved first? Anybody? Who thinks the blood cells evolved first? I did this at the park sometime with some kids, okay? And they said that the heart evolved first. And I said, well, how long is the heart going to live without blood cells? And they said, well, blood cells. And I said, how long are blood cells going to live without a heart? Well, then a heart. See, everything has to be fully formed, fully functional, right from the get-go, or it's dead. You know, we have vital organs where we can't live without them. And I said, you know, even if you had the heart and blood cells, how long is that going to live without lungs? How long is that going to live without a skeletal system and a digestive system and a muscular system? You know, I would say it clearly says it couldn't have evolved. It had to be created. That's my perspective. Just something for you to think about. And that comes really close. I mean, it's very pivotal on how life began. And so how did life begin? Life is so complicated. So complicated. And I want you to see the complexity of your cell. The cell makes a spaceship look like a tinker toy.
It's been called one of the wonders of the molecular world, an amazing nanoscale machine. ATP synthase is a high-tech micromolecular power generator inside the cells of your body. It generates adenosine triphosphate, or ATP, an energy molecule that provides fuel that every one of your cells needs to function. Without this fuel, your cells will cease operation, and so will you.
And so will you. Without that energy, you're dead. My question to the evolutionists is, hey, how did we live before that thing evolved? And you're going to take a look at this. Just this is going to, it's just amazing. the incredible complexity for that energy source.
The ATP synthase machine has many parts we recognize from human-designed technology. A rotor, a stator, a drive shaft, and other basic components of a rotary engine. The ATP synthase is one of thousands of elegantly designed molecular machines inside your cells that make your life and all known life possible. ATP synthase, an example of intelligent design.
Yeah, I would say intelligently designed, that's not just gonna come by chance random processes. But what is an evolutionist gonna do? They're going to look at that, and it's screaming design. So Francis Crick, he's the co-discoverer of the DNA molecule, he says, biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they see was not designed, but rather evolved. Why must you constantly keep that in mind? Because it is screaming at you that this is designed. The only way you can keep your evolution atheism is to plug your eyes, close your eyes and plug your ears and say, no, not listening. It had to be designed. But why does he think like that? He says the origin of life appears at the moment to be almost a miracle. That's right. It is a miracle. You know, you can't get life from non-life. That's the law of biogenesis. You can't get that life. But why does he think this? This is the key to all this. Remember, it's our belief systems. It's our belief systems mainly because about God. It says the ultimate aim of modern development of biology is, in fact, to explain all biology in terms of physics and chemistry. So what is he doing right there? He just eliminated God from the equation. He's not even going to consider it. And he's the co-discoverer of the DNA molecule. He saw how marvelously complex that was. Did he believe in God? No, he became an alienist. He believes in aliens. He's got this theory called panspermia. Google it sometime. Panspermia. That's how life came to Earth. And there's a lot of people looking at alien life. I mean, Bill Nye, he said, Richard Dawkins goes along with it. Bill Nye thinks it's not crazy to think that life came from a Mars rock. Yeah, you're just a bunch of, came from a rock. He thinks that's not crazy. And so we need to think a little, open our minds to think of all options. And this evolutionist says the chance of higher life forms might have evolved, might have emerged this way is comparable with the chance of a tornado sweeping through a junkyard and assembling a Boeing 747 from the material. It just ain't can't happen. It's screaming design. And I'm saying, yeah, if you allow God into science, we don't have to break any laws of science. Evolutionists have to break a lot of laws of science. Okay, but what do they do in this textbook? This is what you're paying good money for. This textbook was either $130 or $85. I got it here at your bookstore, okay? For three paragraphs, and check this out, to the best of our knowledge, that's not science, that's fiction, okay? The Earth was too hot for life, okay? Too hot, no oxygen, not protected by the ozone, ultraviolet radiation. Then right here, rained on the rock for millions of years. Basically, dinosaurs came from rain on the rock for millions of years. That's the ultimate source of dinosaurs. And again, I don't believe that. I don't have enough faith to believe that. People say, yeah, you believe the Bible? And I said, yeah. And doesn't that take faith? Yeah. But not nearly enough faith to believe that dinosaurs came from a rock. So how are they going to get life in your general ed textbook? One magical word. Look at this. It says, somehow. Somehow. Somehow is a huge fuzzy word. Somehow. Despite this harsh environment, living organisms appeared 3.8 billion years ago. Somehow. That's not science. That's fiction. And then look at that whole chapter. You know, the words are just gonna come flowing off that whole chapter. It's just amazing. So that's what you need to do. They were saying that the media mixes it in the conclusions. Well, so does the science book. This is their conclusion, and these are the words that flow off the page, like water off a Niagara Falls. As best as we can surmise, the story of origins, fiction, apparently arose, some scientists speculate, probably originated, probably diverged, and our best guess. That's in your book. I can show you the page. Yeah, it's right there. Page 510 to 523. That's not science. That's not verifiable. That's somebody's opinion, and they have to go to such great lengths because they don't believe in God. And again, what do? Then a miracle occurred. They throw this comic at creationists all the time, God of the gaps, you know, and then God did it. Well, I'm throwing it right back at you, evolutionist. Somehow is a miracle. Somehow. How do you get matter from nothing? That violates laws of physics. That's what happened to Spike Pizarres. He went into the military space program as an atheist and an evolutionist, and he came out as a Christian and a creationist. And I said, Spike, what happened? He said that there was an evolution or a creationist there, and he thought he was an idiot. You know, doesn't he know that science can prove everything without God? And he started to challenge the creationist worldview, and it stood up under scrutiny. And then the creationist turned the table on him. And I said, did the creationist ask you any question that just stopped you in your tracks? And he said, yeah. He said, he asked me, how do you believe in the Big Bang and the laws of physics at the same time? You can't have both. You can't have matter coming from nothing, like the first law of thermodynamics says. And we do a whole talk on that also. So here you got it. This is the dinosaurs. Amphibians, fishes, invertebrates, the earth forms. You know, rained on the rocks for millions of years. I got a question. Where'd the rocks come from? Good question. That came up at the Bill Nye Ken Ham debate. And where'd the atoms for the Big Bang come from? Bill Nye, the science guy, says, that's a great mystery. Basically, he doesn't have a clue. Ken Ham said, well, there's a book that tells us where matter came from. And there was another question like that. How did consciousness come from matter? Bill Nye, don't know, it's a mystery. Ken Ham, there's a book that tells us where consciousness came from. But why is it a mystery for Ken Ham, or for Mr. Science there? Because the first law of thermodynamics, you can't have matter come from nothing. And then we do another talk, like I said, on that. So when did dinosaurs live? All right, now again, when is a history question. It's not a science question. Go to the historical documents, okay? Oh yeah. So it's like your birthday. How many people know when you were born? Okay. How do you know that? How do you know when you were born? Anybody?
History.
If parents told you, okay, an eyewitness account. Is there any other way you can know when you were born?
First certificate,
historical document, exactly right. Is there a scientific test that tells you when you were born? What?
To answer the previous question, the Julian calendar exists. I mean, we have
We'll get to which question was that? When you were born?
Yes.
When you were born, the Julian calendar tells you when you were born.
Well, yeah, we have a calendar set, you know, like many other cultures.
Right, but how do you know which day you were born?
Falls on the date of the Julian calendar.
Right, but how do you know which day to pick from? There's a lot of days
on
that Julian. What?
It's the one that falls on.
Right, but how do you know which one it is? How do you know when your birthday is? Which one of these days that have gone by in the calendar is your birthday, and how do you know?
Well, answer that question for me. Present your evidence.
Well, I'm saying that eyewitness account, like my mom and dad told me, I believed them. Okay, birth certificate, historical document, I believe that too. Okay, but is there a scientific test? Can they take a blood test to tell you when you were born? No, there's not. Can anybody tell me when Mount St. Helens blew up? Anybody? It was May 18th, 1980. And how do we know that? It was a well-documented fact. They knew it was going to blow up. They told the people, get out of here, it's going to blow up. There's a guy named Harry Truman. He lived there. He was really old, not the president. And he said, I don't believe it's going to blow up. And he's under a whole bunch of mud right now. Just because you don't believe something doesn't mean it's not going to happen. Okay, so how do we know it blew up? Historical documents. We got the pictures, the dates. Okay, is there a scientific test that can tell us when Mount St. Helens blew up? Actually, there is. It's called radiometric dating. These guys from the radioisotopes in the age of the Earth, they went to the lava dome. It was 10 years later. They took some of the lava, they sent it off to labs and said, can you tell us how old this is? It's rather young. And it came back with these tests right here. This is millions of years. And so that's 350,000 years, 340,000 years, 900,000 years, 1.7 million years, and 2.8 million years. Radiometric dating doesn't work. And it never works when we know how old the rocket is. And I can show you example after example, but I'll blow through this for the sake of time. But when it doesn't, if we know how old the rock is and it doesn't work, why should we believe it when we don't know how old the rock is? Because they have unknowable assumptions. So again, what is the scientific evidence? Now we're going to go into the laboratory. Okay, the Bible says dinosaurs were made thousands of years ago. Evolution says that dinosaurs evolved from rocks billions of years ago and became dinosaurs 250 million years ago and then went and died 65 million years ago. Okay, so what does the laboratory say? Well, they found red blood. How many people know that they found red blood cells in a T-Rex bone? Good. There's probably 30-40%. That's pretty good. That's better than most places I speak. It's the best kept secret in paleontology. But experts thought that such structures would have decayed and vanished long ago. Okay, but Schweitzer has found evidence of delicate structures which as blood vessels and red blood cells have survived for millions of years. All right? So again, let's separate the facts. What's verifiable? what's verifiable is she found blood cells in red blood cells, or blood vessels in blood cells. That's verifiable. How about this 80 survived millions of years? That's not verifiable. They're mixing the facts with the interpretation of the facts in the same sentence. Okay, this is a fact. This isn't. So let's see what the science says. Let's see what she says. You know, and just keep in mind, they're not going to touch the date of the dinosaurs. That's not even open to debate. That's 70 million years. 70 million years, then they're going to say it's a fact. And why is that? Because evolutionists believe in that geologic column as much as a creationist believes in the Bible. And we're not changing either one. And they're going to have to do incredible mental gymnastics to keep believing in millions of years. But let's hear it from her words.
Is that amazing to find this kind of soft tissue in a fossil this old? And what can the soft tissue really tell us?
Well, it's very amazing. It's utterly shocking, actually, because it flies in the face of everything that we understand about how tissues and cells degrade. It's not something that any one of us could ever predict or hope for.
It flies in the face of everything that we understand. It flies in the face of all the scientific evidence. Now listen to this. Just listen to how many times they'll say fact of 70 million years. And 70 million years is not verifiable. It's not a fact.
And one of the exciting things about this discovery, correct me if I'm wrong, is the fact that this stuff was fossilized as it was. Of 70 million years old, you don't expect to find soft tissue, do you?
Not at all. No. It was utterly shocking.
So you have to sort of rewrite the book as far as fossilization goes, I assume.
Well, that's the exciting part for me. I've always been very intrigued by how things change in going from a living being to part of the rock record. And like I said, a lot of our science doesn't allow for this. All of the chemistry and all of the molecular breakdown experiments that we've done don't allow for this. So if this material turns out to be actual remnants of the dinosaur, then yes, I think we will have to do some certainly rethinking of some of the basics of the model of fossilization.
You know, Mary, when I was reading about this story, I was amazed that in some of the capillaries, when you went to pull them, they snapped right back. Are you amazed at the quality of these remains?
Absolutely.
70 million years old, huh?
It's just doesn't seem possible.
Doesn't seem possible. It's not possible. According to their scientific breakdown experiments, it's not possible. So why not change the date to the dinosaur? Because that puts their evolution at that threatens their foundation, their evolutionism. And this is what Discover writes about this. Notice the headline, Schweitzer's Dangerous Discovery. She found bone in her blood in a dinosaur bone. What's so dangerous about that? Who's going to die because of that? What's it dangerous to? It's dangerous to evolution, for sure. Dangerous for the people that get a lot of power and prestige and their money because of evolution. It's dangerous to that, but it's not dangerous. Science should go wherever the evidence leads, right? And let's just read some of these quotes. So when this shy paleontologist found soft, fresh-looking tissue inside T-Rex firmer, she erased the line between past and present. She did. She brought the dinosaurs right up to the present. And they're going to do incredible mental gymnastics not to have that happen. You know, she said that these bones stink, just like real regular cadavers. And her boss says, yeah, all Hell Creek bones stink. Yeah, and then down here it says, do you realize you get red blood cells? And she says, I just got goosebumps, because everyone knows these things don't last 65 million years. Everyone knows that. And I'm saying, yeah, they're not 65 million years old. And when she showed Horner the slide, she recalls, Jack said, prove to me they're not red blood cells. We're going to see how open-minded Jack is in a few minutes. He doesn't want that evolution theory threatened at all. Okay? And then they found, sure enough, there's blood vessels all over the place. All over the place. I was at fair evangelism one time, and I brought this up again with an atheist, and he goes, how do you know there was dinosaur blood in the dinosaur bone? I said, because it was in dinosaur bone. And he said, how do you know another blood didn't leach in there? You know? and I said, it's because it's in a bone. And he goes, well, maybe some other animal's blood leached in there. And you should have seen his wife look at him. It's like, what kind of logic is that? But she found, through the microscope, she could see what looked like perfectly formed osteocytes, the cells inside bones. And those can't last millions of years. Okay, the past was roaring to life. So she found osteocytes. She's an evolutionist. Okay, let's see what happens when a creationist finds osteocytes. This is a photo from Mark Armitage. He was from California State Northfield. And he found osteocytes in a triceratops horn. Okay, nobody had ever done that before. He got it published in a peer-reviewed journal, something that never been done. This is the first report of sheets of soft tissue from a triceratops horn bearing layers of osteocytes, and extends the range and types of dinosaur specimens known to contain non-fossilized material in bone matrix. All right? So he did that. Did he get a raise? Did he get promoted? You can listen to this. Go into rsr.org. This is my favorite site by far, rsr.org. There's got a radio show every Friday. You got scientists talking about what's happening. He's on there one time, and he got fired. The evolutionist kept her job. The creationist got fired. They did the same thing. See, there's a witch hunt. It's not unusual. Chapter after chapter after chapter, there's three volumes of book, Slaughter of the Dissidents. You don't bow down to that evolutionary theory, your job's in jeopardy. You may not get tenure. You may not get into grad school. You may not get scholarships. It's all happening. It's a very protected belief system. And if you kick the sacred cow, things could get really ugly for you. And so this is RSR, Bob Inyard. He's a pastor out in Denver, and he's had this radio show for decades. And he saw what was happening, so he made some predictions, like scientists are supposed to do. They're supposed to make predictions. And he predicted that soft tissue would be found not only in rare circumstances, but rather easily when looked for. And it was confirmed. And then he made another prediction. He said, basically, you're going to find it everywhere in the fossil record. He said, original dinosaur and biological tissue will be found largely independent of the claimed age of the fossil. Again, double confirmed. The Journal of Paleontology reported that soft tissue in Precambrian beard worms that are allegedly 530 million years old, not 65, 530 million. See, that geologic column is not a sign of millions of years, which we're seeing, it's a sign of a flood. Things had to be buried rapidly. Remember, Dreadnoughtus had to get swallowed whole so it could be fossilized. It has to be buried rapidly or it's not going to turn into a fossil. Therefore, all those layers of sedimentary rock that have fossils in them had to be laid down rapidly. It's not millions of years, it's a sign of a flood. Dr. Walt Brown, when he started thinking on those terms, and he's a PhD grad from MIT, he said, well, if the geologic column is evidence of a flood, where's the evidence for evolution? And for 2 years, he started asking his colleagues that. And after 2 years, he couldn't find any. Remember? Verifiable stuff? And he became a creationist. Okay. And if you want to find Bob Inyard's site, just go into Google and type in dinosaur soft tissue. It's going to be the top site. It's the most comprehensive soft tissue site on the internet. And that's what an atheist says, an evolutionist says. And again, Real Science Radio, it's actually KGov. But that's the radio station that he's on. I like rsr.org. And so what Bob did, remember Jack Horner? He didn't want him to be blood cells. Bob Inyard, he calls up Jack, and he says, hey, I'll give you $20,000 to carbon date that dinosaur bone. Here's the letter. He sent him, I'll give you $20,000. And Jack says, well, we can't do that test here. And Bob says, well, you don't have the equipment? He says, no, we don't. He goes, I'll pay for the test. So it's $23,000. They'll give you 20 grand. We'll give you 3 grand for the test. For 23 grand. And you can listen to this on YouTube. Just go into YouTube, you can hear the conversation and listen to an evolutionist squirm. He's trying so hard not to carbon date it. Because he says, you know, carbon dating only lasted for, you know, 60,000 years. And we wouldn't expect to find any carbon in a dinosaur bone. And then Bob says, yeah, but, you know, you wouldn't expect to find any blood cells in there either. And just listen to him, him and Han. And finally, Jack says, that's not going to help. My question is, help what, Jack? Help science or help evolution? And so he never tested it. He never took the 20 grand. But that point is moot because other scientists did carbon date the dinosaur bones, and they came up with ages from 22,000 to 39,000. All right? And this was at the 2012 Western Geophysics meeting in Singapore. What do you think happened to that? I mean, they did the science, and this is where it was. This is the accelerator mass spectrometry limits. They're accurate up to 43,000. And nowadays it's 55,000. It's all within the accuracy. What do you think happened to them? They just get censored. You can't kick the sacred cow, even if it's a scientific symposium. The abstract was removed from the conference website by two chairmen because they could not accept the findings. Unwilling to challenge the data openly, they erased it from public view. But thank God for the internet, because you can watch this. You can look at the data. And that's what I'm encouraging you to do. Study this out for yourself. Okay, don't take what your textbook is saying. That's all slanted. And if you go into my website, my YouTube site, this one right here, I like the ones that I used for this site. You can look at this. Look at where they found them, look at the studies they did, look at the labs that they sent it to. And not only are we finding C14 in dinosaur bones, proving that they're thousands, not millions of years, we're finding C14 in everything. C14 in diamonds, C14 in coal. It says that the radioactive element carbon-14 breaks down quickly within a few thousand years. Why do we still find it in fossils and diamonds? It's a dilemma for evolutionists because they believe in millions of years, but not a dilemma for creationists. So the science is coming strongly down on the Bible side. And it says organic materials taken from rock layers such as fossils, coal, limestone, natural gas, and graphite all have metal-radiocarbon. And that's not going to last over 60,000 years. So therefore, all of that is recent. All right. You think that was kind of controversial. This is the controversial part of my talk, really. The other stuff is just science. That's what the science says. It's, are you going to accept it or not? Are you going to do mental gymnastics? And so did scientists, and these fossils, you can look at molds of these on the back table. And this is Dr. Carl Baugh. He excavated one of the largest, I forget what it's called, but it's a, like a triceratops, no, it's a T-Rex with spikes on the back. It was like 20 feet tall. And he's, so he's very good at what he does. And he's right next to a foot in Permian rock. Now understand where Permian is on the geologic column. Permian is before dinosaurs, way before people. How in the world did you get a human footprint way back then? I'm saying way back then, it wasn't way back then. And there was a lot of hubbub at Glen Rose, Texas. We went down there. They have a, basically the story is there was a flood that ripped off a layer of bedrock 100 years ago. There's a Dinosaur Valley State Park. There's dinosaur footprints in that river still today. Okay? And I took pictures of it. And these are the dinosaur footprints. The controversial part is there was human footprints back then. And this is what they wrote about him in the 1930s. In 1930, Roland T. Byrd, field explorer for the American Field Museum, reported 15 to 20 inch long, clearly defined human footprints with the dinosaur footprints. That destroys evolution right there. Right there. And so you're thinking 15 to 20 inches, that's pretty big for a human. I mean, my foot is 11 inches. And this is 15 to 20 inch, okay? And you're telling me that, well, actually, the largest person on record, according to the Guinness Book of Records, was Robert Wadlow. And he lived in Alton, Illinois, and he lived to be 8 feet 11 inches. And his foot was, I think it was 18 inches long. Okay, so that's well within acceptable. But are you telling me that giants are, were in the earth in those days? Actually, that's what the Bible says. In Genesis 6:4, there were giants in the earth in those days. And these could be footprints from those giants. And this is what people that were, they did a movie about this. This must have been in the 70s, I think. And this is from a professor from a state college. It was not made by, if not made by man, we don't know what kind of animal produced them. Completely human, shape of a foot, human footprint. If it were not for the Cretaceous limestone, they would have been considered human. See, they're blinded by their evolutionary millions of years. You can't have a human footprint before the dinosaurs. They're blinded, they're twisting the evidence. And so, and you can see this again on my YouTube channel. Just go and I encourage you. I'm not telling you what to think, but before you come to a conclusion on this, go see what Don Patton says. Go see what Carl Baugh says. And these guys have gone over to colleges, gone around, all around colleges and talked to people. That they'll say, well, they eroded, okay? They eroded, you know, left, right, left, right, left, right. Yeah, it's kind of hard to believe. Well, they were carved. And so this guy said, well, he saw two footprints going into the riverbank, so he moved 6 feet of riverbank. It was clay and limestone. He got down to the bottom and he saw 9 more footprints. So they weren't carved, human footprints. And this is what he found in the riverbank. It's hard on that theory because that's the same layer as the dinosaurs. Looks like a human. Why won't it be a human one? And then they had the Dallas Crime Lab go out there and look at them. And they said, yeah, they're human. No problem. And they also excavated the longest consecutive dinosaur trail on the American continent. And there's also, they've got one of those in Russia, too. And this is what the Russian scientist said. If we speak about the human footprint, it was made by a human-like animal. Incredibly, this footprint is on the same plateau where there are dinosaur tracks. Okay, and that's science in the USSR. So we're finding these tracks all over the world. And you can go to this Creation Evidence Museum. This is Carl Baugh's. And this was a replica. This is a mold of a foot that they found there. And they said, well, somebody carved it. And so they cut through the heel because there should be some compression ridges there. And they found compression ridges. So they said, well, somebody carved human toes on the dinosaur foot. And so they cut through the toes. And guess what they found? Compression ridges. This is legit. This is legit. And, but they, you know, this isn't in the textbooks. Trust me on that one. That's going to be hard to explain to the kids. And then they said, well, there's a, you know, it's not human because there's a ball in there. There's a, it raises up. And you guys can come and look at this later. And they said it's not human. They go, well, how do you know what a human footprint looks like? So they did some more observational science. They did standing, walking, and running human footprints. And this is a running human footprint. Your heel hits and it rolls over and pushes off. That's why it's rounded there. And that's what they found. All right, it's a running human footprint with the dinosaur layers. The question is, what do you think they were running from? And then they found this one. This is in Don Patton's thing. This was one that they couldn't get around, they couldn't explain it. And so he presented this footprint in Tennessee. The next day, somebody was on a plane to Glen Rose, Texas, and beat the crap out of it. All right? So just watch this. They've got the pictures and all this stuff. They got it documented. But if you can't win the argument, you got to destroy the evidence. Okay, so and this again is a human footprint in the Permian level. Here's a dinosaur stepping on a human footprint. They didn't have to cut this one. They could do an x-ray, and it's got the same compression ridges. Here's a handprint. You can see this in the back and with the dinosaur. There's a hammer, too, that they found in that same layer. Basically, there's a lot of stuff that points to humans and dinosaurs living together. And you can go to Blandings, Utah, in the Natural Bridges Park. How did Indians know what dinosaurs looked like if they'd never seen it? And there's art all over the world with this. You know, it's a long-necked dinosaur. How in the world did the Indians know what a long-necked dinosaur looked like if they never saw them? This was in Utah also, a pterodactyl. How would they know what a pterodactyl looked like if they never saw it? Lake Superior. How would they know what a stegosaurus looked like? Grand Canyon. How would they know what that looked like if they never saw it? It's getting pretty hard to say that man didn't live with evolution. It lived with dinosaurs. 1535, Spanish conquistadors mentioned there were stones with strange creatures on them. Okay, what were these strange creatures? They were dinosaurs. Again, how did people draw them and carve them? These are from 1,000 years ago, and they got the varnish on it to prove their age. Notice the circles. You don't know what the skin looks like when you find the bones, but how would they know what they look like? How would somebody 1,000 years ago know how to draw a dinosaur? How could they do that if they never saw one? Triceratops, and these are anatomically correct. Sometimes these are so anatomically correct, the scientists catch up to it. Sometimes they're more accurate than what the scientists think. But this was in Journal of Creation. Can they be authenticated scientifically? And yes, they can. They sent some frauds and some other ones to labs, and yeah, they could tell them apart. Okay, and then this is a death mask. Notice the dinosaur head down here with the stegosaurus back and the tail going around. Okay, and this is from 500 BC, some of this pottery. How did they know if they never saw it? And so the evidence is getting pretty strong that dinosaurs and man lived contemporarily. How else could they draw them? Like, you go over into Europe, this is a coin from 1609. Again, notice the dragon at the bottom, or the dinosaur. And they carve them on castles. Notice the dinosaur in Wales. This one is in the Netherlands. The dinosaur getting killed. How did they know how to draw a dinosaur if they never saw it? I'm just going to keep asking that over and over again. This really, really puzzled, what's his name, the cosmos guy, Carl Sagan. Again, this was built in the 1500s. We didn't find the dinosaur bones till the 1800s. How can they draw a dinosaur? And you might be saying, well, they're just carving legends. But you got to be pretty good at carving a legend to know what his skin looks like. And they get the skin right. It's amazing what's happening. Right here, there's the skin. There's the skin. How do you know what the skin of a dinosaur looks like if you just find the bones? They had to see him alive. They had to. And we found dinosaur skin. It's got circles on it. Dinosaur skin again. And so, you know, the evidence, it's getting harder and harder to deny that man saw dinosaurs. In Cambodia, 1,000 years ago, we know when the temple was built. What does that look like? Anybody? What does that look like?
Stegosaurus.
Exactly. How in the world could somebody 1,000 years ago draw one of these if they never saw one? How in the world could that happen? Yeah. And this is my friend's son. He was over in Iraq. He's a Marine, Special Forces, real interesting. In Babylon, you get these long-necked dinosaurs on the wall. And they show up in the Bible, in the Catholic Bible anyway. They got some extra books, not inspired, but in chapter 14, it talks about Daniel killing a dragon, okay? This great dragon, okay? He's talking about a great dragon. And look at the arches in Babylon. Why do you need arches that big? Unless your god, the dragon, is walking through them. Something to think about. Okay, does anybody have any questions right now? I'm just going to take a real quick break. Anybody? Yes, sir.
You said you went to the area where you saw the steps, correct?
Right, yes, sir.
Did you see the human prints then?
They're not there anymore.
They're not?
Okay. They're not, no. They've been either eroded or they've been removed.
Okay.
Okay. All right. Yeah, so that's a good question. But again, these things are showing up. This is Bishop Bell's brass behemoth, okay? And this is around his grave, and he died. It was in 1496, two long-necked dinosaurs. Again, long-necked dinosaurs with their necks crossing. Long-necked dinosaurs with their necks crossing. This is from antiquity. I think this is the oldest artifact we have, long-necked dinosaurs with their necks crossing. It's interesting. Somebody put words to this. The first words are, look at her, she's all neck and legs.
She's all neck and legs, look at her.
Oh, I am looking at her.
Stop looking at her!
You just told me to look at her!
Ow!
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 Ow! I was trying to be throat that.
See, giraffes do that. Maybe those long-necked dinosaurs did. I don't know. But it's interesting that their necks are always crossed. Just something to consider. If dinosaurs lived with man, won't they show up in literature and history and art? Well, they will, but you can't look for dinosaur because that's a modern word. That was started in 1841. This is an 1828 dictionary. So what do you think, what word would represent dinosaurs? Anybody have? Yes, sir?
Dragon.
Dragon, exactly right. And look at the definition of dragon here. Dragon, a noun, a genus of animals, the Draco. They have four legs, a cylindrical tail, and membrane wings, rated like the fins of a flying fish. It's a genus from way back then. Why would they say it's a genus if they'd never seen one? They describe it pretty well, but Gilgamesh slayed a dragon, Beowulf slayed a dragon, and there's thousands of dragon legends around the world. And this is people separated by time and distance, and it really bothered Carl Sagan. So he wrote this book called Dragons of Eden, okay, where he's trying to say how the memories of dragons got passed down through our DNA. And that's not scientific at all. That's been debunked. You can write that down, Dragons of Eden. And then in history, St. George killed a dragon. He was martyred for his faith. Again, that's a cloth in the 1600s, killing the dragon. Alexander the Great, his soldiers were scared by dragons in the cave. Marco Polo went to China, and he said that the emperor raises dragons to pull his chariots in his parade. And you ever wonder about, they use it for medicine too, but the Chinese zodiac, it's got 11 real animals and a mythical one. Why do they have a mythical one? Maybe they really lived. And why does the Bible refer to Satan as a lion, a serpent, and a dragon? You know, if the Satan's real, why would God refer to him as something that's mythical? And I think it's real. So, okay, are dinosaurs in the Bible? Again, that's going to depend. You're going to look for dragons, and it's going to depend on which Bible you use. You use the King James, it's going to be in there 35 times. You use a modern version, it's going to be in there like 15 times. And this is the NIV, dragon or dragons, 14 times. They aren't going to have dragons in there at all. So it's going to depend. See, they have no dragons at all in the NIV. Okay, but the Bible does describe behemoth. It says, behold now behemoth. Behold now, this is in Job 40:15. God's talking to Job, giving him an attitude adjustment. He says, behold now behemoth. So whatever behemoth is, God could look, or Job could look at him. God's saying, look at behemoth, okay? Which I made with thee. He eats grass as an ox, so it's not an alligator, okay? And though his strength is in his loins, the force is in the navel of his belly. So this Catholic Bible says, oh, behemoth is a hippo, because hippos have big bellies. And they're right. Hippos have big bellies. Yeah, they're big. This NIV Bible says it's a hippo or an elephant, because they got big bellies too. Well, if big belly's all it takes, you know, maybe this guy's behemoth, right? No, but if you read longer, read more, it says he moves his tail like a cedar. He's the chief of the ways of God. This is basically God saying, look at the biggest thing I ever made. He moves his tail like a cedar. Does a hippo have a cedar tail? No, not at all. Does an elephant? Not at all. Behold now behemoth. The long-necked dinosaur. That's what God's talking to Job about in Job 40:15. Behold now behemoth. He moves his tail like a cedar now, doesn't he? And they're finding behemoths all over the place. So just keep that in mind. That geologic column is a record of a flood. It's not a record of millions of years. And if we interpret these fossils wrong, we're going to have the wrong perspective of the past. And you're going to say, well, how do you get something as big as Dreadnoughtus onto the Ark? Has anybody been to the Ark? This is in, you've been to the Ark. Praise God for that. What was it like?
It was really cool.
Really cool?
It, I don't know. Like, it was cool because one part of it had all these crates and these animals, and you could, like, hear it and all the birds
and everything. So you could, like, the cages and the crates. Okay, good. Well, the elephants, you know, remember Behemoth made elephants look like puppy dogs? How are you going to get that big behemoth in there through that door? Well, you don't have to take the biggest one. You take the biggest ones were once little. You don't have to take the big mom and daddy. You can take the baby one, right? And you get them through the door. And then the Bible also talks about whales in chapter 1. And that's a marine or land animal, land monster. Those plesiosaurs. And the Loch Ness Monster, thousands of people say they saw a Loch Ness Monster. Some of them are fake, but some of them might be real. But why would they say that? So they put a motion detector camera in the Loch Ness, and this thing swam by. Two paddle-shaped, and this thing washed up onto the beach in California, had a 20-foot neck, and they said it was a plesiosaur. Okay, this thing got pulled up in Japan in 1977. This is the actual picture. 1977, they pulled it up. It was 4,000 pounds, 32 feet long. The person who was there said it was a plesiosaur. The people who weren't there say that it was a basking shark. So it's up to you, who are you going to believe? Somebody who was there said it was a plesiosaur, or somebody who wasn't there says it's a basking shark? And in Japan, they have this commemorative stamp commemorating that find. It's a plesiosaur. And this washed up in Spain in 2013. I remember getting this off the internet. And I kept telling my wife, they're going to say it's a basking shark, they're going to say it's a basking shark, they're going to say it's a basking shark. And about 3 or 4 hours later, guess what? It's definitely a shark. I don't look like no shark. No. It looks like this art from 600 BC. So could there still be dinosaurs alive? There could be. In Africa, they got long-necked dinosaur stories from the natives. Okay, and so what happened to the dinosaurs? This is the most common question. What happened? They couldn't survive after the flood. Before the flood, did they turn into birds? Absolutely not. There's so many differences between birds and dinosaurs. I don't know why they're trying to connect them. I don't know why that why that's important. Their lungs are different. Their hips are different. Their hearts are different. You know, dinosaurs have solid bones. Birds have hollow bones. You know, one's cold-blooded. The other's warm-blooded. And there's a big difference between scales, which is just a fold in the skin, and feathers, which is incredibly intricately designed. So what I think happened to the dinosaurs is there was more oxygen before the flood. And I go and I have a whole talk on that. We're going to talk about that in Little Falls at Riverside Bible Church on April 9th. But there was more oxygen before the flood. And this is what this guy says. You know, an 80-foot apatosaurus, that's Dreadnoughtus, known as Brontosaurus, said I had the nostrils the same size as a horse. How are you going to get enough oxygen through his nostrils when you're that big? He says dinosaurs could not have existed without more oxygen in the air, and that's what we find in amber bubbles. When air bubbles trapped in amber, it's got 50% more oxygen. Those have 32. The article I showed you before was 35% oxygen. Today we have 21%, and there's reasons for that. And this is what Carl Baugh is trying to do. He's trying to simulate the pre-flood conditions. He's got this hyperbaric chamber where it's got more oxygen, more air pressure, and more magnetic strength around it. And I had the pleasure of going down to the Twin Cities Creation Science and listening to him speak, but I got there early so I could eat with him, and I asked him, you know, I heard that your piranhas grow four times as big in that thing. And he looks at his friend and he smiles and he goes, at least four times as big. So things grow bigger in the pre-flood conditions. And what he wants to do is make a dinosaur. Yeah, he thinks if he can get a certain type of lizard, not just any lizard, but a certain type of lizard in there, the mommy and daddy won't turn into the dinosaur, but the offspring will, because in the development they're going to have all the potential. But anyway, things were bigger in the past than today. This is supposed to be an 8-foot-long beaver, and this is a modern one. Okay, this picture I took at the museum in St. Louis, Mastodon Museum. So what happened to the dinosaurs? They couldn't exist in the harsher environment. Also, they were killed for meat. God told the people, told man, you can eat meat now. But I think they were killed because they were menace. You don't want your children playing next to a Triceratops, you know, or a T-Rex. You know, just like today, you don't want to play it next to a python. You're going to eliminate that so it's safe. I think that's what happened to the dinosaurs. They got eliminated by man. So again, let's wrap this up and put a bow on it. Let's separate the facts from the conclusions. Okay, the facts are verifiable. Can you verify that? That's the fact. Okay, everything else, and the scientists, they do the same thing. They mix the conclusions in with the facts. And so that's the question. And I encourage you to study this out. I'm not trying to tell you what to think. I'm just showing you there's another way to think. And study it. Analyze this. If you go into my YouTube channel, these are the ones, a lot of my talk is based on these videos right here. So just go in there and see what they found. And we'll get to you in just a minute. And there's scientific journals. You can come up and take a look at these scientific peer-reviewed journals if you're scientifically inspired. And again, these clues are clues to the past. These facts, verifiable facts, are clues to the past. If we misinterpret these clues, if we think they're millions of years old, our perspective of the past will be wrong. These are signs of a flood. Okay, our perception of the present will be wrong. We're going to think we're mutated animals instead of made in the image of God. And our focus on the future will be wrong. We're going to think, well, I can live what I want, and I'm just going to go to the grave. Nothing, no big deal. But that's wrong. There's a heaven and there's a hell. So we need to interpret these fossils properly, or you could make the same mistakes that a lot of people did. And that's why we're here tonight. We're going to have Pastor Kakuza give the most important message of the night right now. But again, look at the fossil record, and this is what's in most of the fossils are remains of marine invertebrates. 95% of the marine, 95% of the fossils are marine invertebrates. That's clams, basically. Clams all over the place. And the 5% that's left, 95% of that are plants and bacteria. And so the vertebrates that they show you in that geologic column, that's less than 0.01% of all the fossils. And so they're found in catastrophic deposits, often in death poses, and incomplete ecosystems. And they find animals with all different kinds of ecosystems mixed together. Fossil graveyards often contain numerous animals from mixed habitats. Saltwater fish are sometimes found with upland dwellers. Crocodile fossils are found with deep sea denizens and desert and Arctic animals. How do you get desert and Arctic animals together with an alligator? I'm saying it's a worldwide flood. A worldwide flood. The flood was God's judgment. And this is a sobering picture, okay? Anybody could have gone into that ark. That ark is a picture of salvation, just like Jesus. There was one way into that ark, just like Jesus. Jesus said, I'm the door. There's only one way into heaven. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. And now think about it. Back then, they had time to get into the ark. But the sobering part is, once that door closed, judgment began. If you weren't in that ark, you got buried in mud. And that judgment day is coming again, and we're offering you the free gift of salvation. So you don't have to be judged by God. You can have Jesus pay for your sins, and you can go to heaven based on what Jesus did. So if you were to die today, where do you think you're going to go? And that's something your kid's going to ask you someday. Yeah, Pastor Kakuza, come on down. If you were going to die, you know, everybody's going to die. Are you going to be like George Washington? His last words were, doctors, I'm dying, but I'm not afraid to die. If you were to die tomorrow, would you be excited to meet your Lord, or would you be scared to death? You're going to meet Jesus one way or the other. It's either going to be as your Savior or as your judge. Pastor Kakuza.
Thank you, Brian, for that great talk. A lot goes into that. And as he mentioned, we're not here to tell you what to think, but we do want you to think. We want you to weigh this out, think it through, investigate it some more. All right? I'm pastor of a Northland Bible Baptist Church here in St. Cloud, founding pastor back in 1981. I'm not here to preach at you tonight. I'm just simply here to, it's sort of a did you know kind of thing. Because I can remember, and by the way, just curious, how many of you are 19 years old? Okay, 18. Lots of you 18, okay. It wasn't until I was 19 years old that I understood what I'm going to share with you right now. I was raised, again, wrong information. I was raised in a religion that basically taught me, well, good boys go to heaven, bad boys go to hell. And, you know, one day you're going to stand before God, and you know, your good works are going to be on this part of the scale, and your bad words are going to be on this part, and depending on which one's heavier is going to determine where you're going to go. Well, there's a problem with that. Just like this issue of creation versus evolution, there's a problem, and we see the problems if you investigate it. Well, the problem with what I was taught was that that's not in the Bible. And let me say this, okay? I've been a Christian for over 40 years now. I was told there were things in the Bible that aren't in the Bible. I was told things that were not true, okay? I was told things about God that were not true. I was told things about the way God is that were not true. I want to tell you just very, very quickly what the Bible says about this issue and how God views you, okay, and what he wants to do for you. And it's not going to cost you anything, all right? So I want you to understand this. He talked about this question here. If you died today, where would you go? You know, that is a great question. Now, I know that you, with the whole concept of evolution, well, you don't go anywhere. You're done. You kind of go the way of the squirrel who gets hit on the road. That's it. There's a problem with that, though, because everybody knows there's more. You have to be told that there's not, because God makes it very clear that there is an afterlife. And it's very interesting. Many, many religions believe there's an afterlife of some kind. The question is, what's the truth and how do you get there? Well, the answer in Christianity is something different than every other religion in the world. Because the Bible says you go to heaven by accepting the gift of eternal life that God offers you. It's not based on your works. Let me explain this to you. This is what, I saw this when I was 19. I'd never seen it before and it made total sense to me. So hopefully I can explain it to where it makes sense to you. If this was to represent you and me, okay? We're going to let my wallet represent the things we do wrong. The Bible calls the things we do wrong sin. Everybody does things wrong. Everybody. Okay? You know that. You know that. We're all sinners, and that includes me. And I'm probably more of a sinner than you are because I'm older than most of you. So I've had more practice. I'm not proud of that, but it's just the truth of it. Here's what the Bible says, though. Religion says this. Oh, you know what? If you're a sinner, God hates you. No, God doesn't hate you. God loves you. He hates our sin. This is the message of the Bible. He hates our sin. He loves us. He hates our sin. You see, sin is an affront to God. He has given us his truths, and it's basically sin as we miss the mark of his perfection. We go against what he says. Our sin is what separates us from him. The Bible tells us that heaven is a perfect place. There's no sin, there's no sorrow, there's no sickness. I just talked about this last Sunday, which was yesterday. Heaven's going to be a perfect place. No misery there, unlike earth. Unlike earth. See, our sin is what causes the problems that we have in the world. Our sin separates us from God. Now, we're all sinners. To go to heaven, though, we have to be sinless. Well, none of us are. We've already blown it. Scriptures say all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, and I think we would agree with that. Now, here's what a lot of people, they don't get. Okay, now, I'm going to share with you right now a little bit of bad news, and then I'm going to share with you the best news in all the world. God says because we've sinned against him, because he's holy and righteous, and heaven is a perfect place, and he's just, wrongdoing demands payment, judgment. Okay? If you don't believe that judgment is right, I guarantee you, if you had a loved one who was brutally murdered, you would want justice. You would want justice. Well, you know what? When we sin against God, when we break his laws and his principles, that's sin. And God says, okay, sin has to be paid for. Now, according to the Word of God, if we paid for our sin, we'd have to spend forever separated from God paying for our sins. Now, that's an awful thought, but that is what the Bible teaches. The wages of sin is death. We'd spend forever separated from God in hell. God doesn't want that. God doesn't want that. Now, I know there are people, especially here on campus, who will say, and very smugly, I can't believe in a God who sends people to hell. I'm here to tell you tonight, God doesn't send anybody to hell. That's the message of the Bible. He doesn't send anybody to hell. As a matter of fact, he proved it by what he did for you and me. Now again, religion says, okay, well, to get rid of my sin, I have to do good things. I have to go to church, be baptized, be a good person. And you know what? Maybe all those things are good, but they don't take away the sin. The only payment God will accept for sin is death. Death. Okay? God says, I don't want you to spend forever separated from me in hell. Therefore, here's what God did. 2,000 years ago, he entered the human race, time and space, the Lord Jesus Christ. This hand representing him, you notice he has no sin. God has no sin. But he understood our sin had to be paid for, but if we did it, we'd spend forever separated from him in hell. God says, I love you so much. He says, I basically saying this in the Bible, I'd rather die than live without you. God is a God of love. And that's why he took on flesh. And when Jesus Christ went to the cross, he didn't die for himself. He died for you and me. And watch this now. All the sin you've done or ever will do wrong to the day you die, he came and he took it all upon himself and he died in your place. He was a substitute. He stepped in for you, stepped in for me, because he doesn't want us lost forever. He wants us with him forever. And Jesus paid the price. Now, I got a question for you. Here's a whole lifetime of sin, okay? Jesus came, he paid for all of it. How much is left? Anybody got a question? Or got an answer? How much is left? None. Simple math, right? Subtraction. Let's say you committed in your lifetime 1,000,000 sins. Jesus came, he paid for all 1,000,000. How many are left? There's none left. If all of your sins are gone, you could go to heaven. Now, this is exactly what Christ did. He died on the cross, paid for our sins, was buried, he came back from the dead 3 days later. The resurrection of Jesus Christ, by the way, is an absolutely locked-tight historical fact. Don't you believe people who say, well, Jesus never existed, or Jesus didn't come back from the dead. Listen, you come talk to us. We can prove, it's absolutely proven that he came back from the dead. Many, many hundreds of eyewitnesses who touched him, who ate with him, who talked with him, he did come back from the dead. It was to prove that sin was paid for. Now, here's the thing. The Bible says all you can do to go to heaven, all you can do to be sure you're going, is to believe or trust in Jesus Christ that he made that payment for you. The moment you do, your sins are taken away, your whole lifetime of sin, and God will give you everlasting life that very moment. Everlasting life is home with him forever in heaven. He says he'll never lose you, he'll never cast you out. Now listen, it's good to be good, but being good will not take away your sin. Okay? John 3:16, I bet a lot of you have heard this. For God so loved the world, that's us, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, trusts in him, should not perish but have everlasting life. Everlasting life. That's good news. You might say, what do I have to do? Simply believe. Believe, trust in Jesus Christ that he made the payment for you, and if you do, he will give you everlasting life. He'll forgive you of all your sin, okay? And you go to heaven. That's why I said earlier, you know, people say, well, I can't believe in a God who sends people to hell. Wait a minute. God made the payment, made it possible for you and me to never go there for 1 second. He did all the work. He paid the price. And he offers it to us as a gift. The Bible says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You notice it's through Jesus Christ, not our works. You can have the gift of eternal life tonight if you'll simply in your mind put your faith, your trust in Jesus Christ. In a sense, you're kind of talking it, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I understand I can't get myself to heaven because I got to be perfect, and I know I'm not. I'm trusting in Jesus Christ right now to give me that gift of eternal life. You're not making promises. You're taking God at his promise. That's how much God loves you. See, for a person to end up spending forever separated from God, it's them rejecting the payment Jesus made. Rejecting the payment. Jesus offers it as a gift. Why would we turn down a gift? Doesn't make any sense. That's what he does. He offers it. If you'll trust Christ, you can be sure of going to heaven. Whenever you die, As a matter of fact, you can be sure tonight of going, because the Bible says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. 1 John 5:13. I know I'm going, not because I'm a pastor. I know I'm going because God's word says so. I've trusted Jesus Christ. And he says, I guarantee you, you can know you're going to heaven. 1 John 5:13. I'm going to have Brian come back up at this time. You can take questions or whatever you'd like to do. Thank you so much for this few minutes. Appreciate it very much.
And I've heard a lot of pastors in my life, and that's the best preacher I've heard. You can hear him on the radio twice on Sunday, 7:30 in the morning on WJON, and 7:30 in the evening on 91.5 FM. I encourage you to listen to it, and come on and visit. If you still go to your church Sunday morning, but come on Sunday night. We have a service at 6 p.m. And we have a Grace Campus Fellowship after this Sunday's evening service. We're going to go out to Culver's. We'd love to get to know you. We really do have a passion for the college students. We know what you're being taught. We want you to know what's true. So does
this may sound corny to y'all, but I'm going to risk it, okay? We really do love you guys. Okay, I remember what it's like. College days are very special to me, and that's why we have this ministry, is because we care about college kids. We want to be a blessing to you.
Right.
So